I love getting the backstories of our guests, and I think it's really important for a few reasons. First, it helps everyone see that the types of people who find success with WordPress and Divi are really varied. And on the other hand, it also starts to reveal certain commonalities, shared attributes, career trajectory patterns that people can recognize in their own life or adopt and replace or augment whatever their default mode of operation is in order to try to get to a better place themselves. So I guess my first question's got to be this then. So what's your story? What was your life like leading up to working with WordPress and Divi?
So I went to design school in Ontario, the York Sheridan design program. So there was a little bit of interactive work in there, but not really. So, you know, we learned HTML and CSS basics, but I never liked any of the interactive courses. So I mostly stuck to the design side. And it wasn't until working at a really small studio after I graduated, it was just me and one guy, Gordon. He was an awesome mentor. And I actually do believe that the first job that you get out of school is, it just kind of sets the tone for the rest of your career. So I feel really, really lucky that I got to work with him for 4 years. Amazing guy. So I got to see how everything worked, right? So it's just, I'm seeing him in client calls. I'm seeing actual proposals. Mm-hmm. I got to see all of the behind the scenes and how he spoke to people. And I think that was a huge part of kind of setting me up for success was how does he actually run a call? How does he run a meeting? How does he talk to people?
Yeah, that's huge.
It's an amazing insight to be able to get to see, you know, the project management side of things, but also the technical and kind of everything.
That's a lot of experience you would not get at a larger agency or anywhere absolutely. Where you're considered an entry-level employee. You know, you just don't get that kind of access.
And there's pros and cons to that too, right? Like, as a result, I am a generalist. And I know there's sort of people say it's not good to be a generalist. I think I have experienced success because of my generalist nature. I don't think it's the same for everyone, of course.
Yeah.
But I just feel like I got a really well-rounded experience working with him. So I stuck that out for 4 years. But towards the end, I was starting to do a little bit more. I mean, I was the only web person on the team. So he's like, great, you want to do a website? I'm like, sure, I learned a bit in school. I'll do that. And as I was telling you before, I worked with TextPattern. Most people haven't even heard of TextPattern. So that was a content management system. It's an open source platform. It's a pretty cool community. But I found it's really hard for clients to work with. It was really hard for them to update. And I just started to feel like it was getting more and more difficult to keep them updated. I had dabbled in WordPress a little bit. And again, this was like 8 years ago or so. So it wasn't what it is today. And the themes aren't what they are today. And I didn't know a ton about PHP. So it was more intimidating for me to try working with WordPress. So I was like, nah, I'm going to stick with this text pattern thing. Then I started hiring developers, actually. So I worked with a developer who did most of my site development for a while. And I was still tinkering around once in a while with WordPress because I was getting clients coming to me that already had WordPress sites. Mm. I was like, I can't talk everybody into switching to some really, you know, not usable admin end when they've been used to working with WordPress. So I started seeing that it was a trend picking up and I was like, if I'm going to adapt, I'm going to have to figure out this WordPress thing.
Yeah, absolutely. What made you decide to break out on your own from the agency? Because it sounds like you had a pretty good relationship there, or at least you enjoyed your role. So what made you decide to strike out on your own?
It had been about 4 years. I was doing a lot of freelance on the side, evenings and weekends, and I was working way too much. But I love the interesting projects that I was working on that were coming in the evenings.
Yeah, and your freelance was as a designer and developer?
Yeah, mostly website stuff, logos, websites, some print material. Like I used to work on a bikini catalog, just like whatever random projects kind of came my way. And I just felt like I needed more control, and I actually really liked the challenge of the client side of things. It was intimidating, but also really, I was just really curious about it. And just at some point, I felt like I'd outgrown my position there. And they sort of knew it too. And I actually talked them into going down to 2 days a week there.
Oh, wow.
So that I could actually have 3 days a week to see if I could do it. And they were, I had such a great relationship with them.
That is a supportive very company and supportive group of people. That's awesome.
Very lucky. I mean, it was him and his wife and his kids. Like, I got to know them so well over the years. And they, of course, wanted me to grow and spread my wings. So they're like, whatever we can do to make it easier, of course. And since I was the only web person there, that was going to make a big dent. And so we needed to make sure that somebody else could kind of fill my shoes.
Yeah, so there was a transition period there. Today, you call yourself a digital strategist. Can you, just to set the sort of tone for the rest of the interview, can you tell us in sort of concrete terms, what exactly is a digital strategist?
Yeah, I define it as, I help people grow online businesses. So it's kind of seeing the big picture of somebody's business. It's integrating marketing practices. It's a little bit of business strategy. It's a little bit of everything. So again, still a bit of a generalist, but I see how all the technical pieces come together. And I also see how the marketing, branding, design pieces all work together to build their audiences, meet their goals, whatever those are, whether it's launching a new product, whether it's launching a new course, trying to increase their sales. So it's still kind of a little bit of everything. But yeah, it's using, you know, market research to help people meet their business goals.
Cool. Was there a time after you broke out on your own where you were a freelance web designer and not a digital strategist, or did you start right away as a digital strategist?
No, I definitely evolved. I mean, I started out as an interactive designer and I think it was, you know, interactive web and design or something like that. And then it was a digital craftswoman. And so I've definitely gone through tons of evolution in terms of my positioning and how I talk about myself.
So that's actually something I'm really interested in, because obviously I think because we're talking about the benefits of transitioning to digital strategists from web designer, WordPress developer, whatever people are labeling themselves. I'm really interested in figuring out, you know, at least one example of what that journey looks like and, you know, what the transition actually looked like in stages. Can you tell us about that journey for yourself?
Yeah. And I see it as a big experiment. Like, I always encourage people to almost to not take it so seriously, right? Like, oh, I need to pick a niche and I need to make sure, you know, I've said exactly what I do and I have all the pieces in my portfolio that support that. And it doesn't always work so cleanly, right? So,
right. Like sometimes you just start taking work and a year down the line, you go, you know what? I'm best at X, Y, Z. Let's package that together. And that's my thing now. Totally. Did it look like that for you, or was it more, I guess, planned out than that? Cause that's, I think, maybe the really random approach. Did you have something in between?
Random and structured. Yeah. It was like the transition wasn't planned. I had no idea where the trajectory that my career was going to go. I was like, I'm Marie, the web designer. Like that's kind of where I was. I didn't know what was possible. Mm-hmm. I didn't know where I was heading. I was just like, great, let's just get bigger projects, bigger clients. Cool. Let's test out the waters. And it probably wasn't until working with Marie Forleo, that I started to really see what was happening in the kind of online marketing world. And I was like, oh, okay, really what I was seeing was design was way too separate from marketing. So people were building these beautiful sites. I was guilty of it. You build a beautiful site and you're like, yay, my job is done. And then it doesn't bring in revenue. It doesn't bring in an audience. It's a pretty website, but with no plan for how are people going to visit it.
Yeah, it's not necessarily integrated into like how they're building their funnels for email building or for email lists or for sales. It's not really, you know, one thing that I like to do, and I think we've probably talked about in our pre-interview, is, you know, just on that idea of stories is, you know, if your brand story, your brand values, if you're not telling that, at least in part with the design of your website, you're kind of missing a big opportunity. And so that would be another example of how you can integrate much more than one aspect of someone's overall digital strategy into a service.
Definitely. I feel like a lot of designers kind of see making money is selling out, which I kind of felt like that, that sentiment was kind of rampant in the design community. Like, oh, don't make me put that opt-in on the site. Like, it's so ugly. And I get it. But so what can we do as designers to challenge, for example, what was happening in the marketing space that was like, you must have a landing page that removes the navigation and tricks people into buying your product and lots of arrows. And that's not the way either. Yeah. So what's the in between like beautiful design and marketing that works? And so that's where I was kind of curious where that intersection happened.
So in your descriptive copy for one of your projects called Digital Strategy School, you say, we help designers transition from fumbling freelancers to trusted advisors.
Yeah.
That makes me think of three questions. And so I'll just ask you 1, 2, 3. First, what makes digital strategy so great compared to, say, like a single niche service like just web design or just development?
I think it's really hard. I think you hit a bit of a cap at some point with design. Like there's a perceived value for someone to pay for a web design, right? Mm-hmm. But at the end of the day, a client doesn't really just want a web design. They don't want even just a website. What they want is a business that works better because you work together, right? Mm-hmm. So, and that could mean a number of things for different people. Is it more sales? You know, like when someone asks for a redesign, what are they actually looking for? There's maybe sales aren't working. Maybe their list isn't growing, whatever that looks like, that it's just kind of a means to an end. So yeah. If you understand what the end goal is and how the design can work towards that, you're at a way better place. And you can even do things like, you can do creative payment models where you say, okay, great. Like let's work on a percentage basis. If I could increase your sales by X percentage, let's talk about what that could look like. And you become more of a trusted partner. You work way more long-term with people because they know you're invested in their success.
You know, what's interesting is I think a lot of designers and developers end up doing those things anyway, but they end up doing it for free because it's not listed as part of their services. People are like, well, I want a website that, you know, one of the basic tenets of good web design is you first identify the objectives. Like, what do you want this design to accomplish for you? Okay, now I'm going to go do that. So what they end up doing as a part of their web design service is optimizing people's sales, doing different things for their business that is totally off the map in terms of web design, but needs to be considered for a good web design, like what we were just talking about. And this, I think, might give people a better way to market themselves, market their real value that they're bringing to the table and make sales that they probably normally wouldn't make.
Exactly. And as you said, a lot of the students have said, oh, I've done this stuff and I do this stuff, but I didn't know that I could charge for it, or I didn't know that it was outside of the scope of design. So
my second question is this something that you would recommend for everyone? Or, you know, like what if someone's perfectly happy and successful with a super niche single service business? Should they let this go and just continue being happy with what they're doing? Or do you think this is something that almost anyone could benefit from?
I do think almost anyone could benefit from it, but I don't think it's necessarily a sort of catch-all. It's not for everyone. And so this is what I've told a lot of the students who said, I don't know if I feel comfortable, for example, putting digital strategy as a service on my site. And I say, you don't have to even be a digital strategist. I'm not even saying that you need to call yourself that. All I'm asking is even to operate more strategically.
Interesting.
So just see the way you offer your services more strategically, the way you even talk about what you do and focusing on the value that you offer. So I don't even plan necessarily on kind of churning out digital strategists everywhere. Yeah. It's just designers that are thinking a little more strategically about how they run their own businesses.
Yeah, that makes a lot of sense because, you know, particularly as I was looking over the total services that you provide underneath your digital strategy umbrella, I mean, I think it could be daunting for a lot of people to get to a place where they feel comfortable billing themselves as authoritative or an expert in all of those categories. And we'll talk more about that in a little bit, though. The third question I wanted to ask is, what kind of freelancer, in your opinion, best transitions into the digital strategist role? Like, so we've talked about how everybody might benefit from thinking more strategically, but have you noticed a certain type of person who's like, all right, you basically have to do this because it's going to be where you shine, or it's going to be where your business blows up?
I think there's a few different types. I mean, obviously go-getters, people that are self-starters and they just kind of need that extra perspective. I'd say anyone that feels overwhelmed, anyone that's like, I don't know where to begin, like what the heck is going on? Maybe they have way too much work on the go and they're not working efficiently. So there's definitely a lot of talk about how do we make space for great projects to happen. If you're kind of putting out a million fires and you're just working with any client that comes through the door, you know, you're making it really difficult to get really big, amazing projects.
When you say someone who's overworked, I think I understand it, but I think it might sound kind of confusing if you're saying, okay, the solution to being less overworked is to provide more services. And I know that's not what you're saying, but I think it might come across that way if someone's kind of uninitiated and they don't really know that when you say that, I think what you're saying is by providing a more extensive, smarter service, you're actually extending, you're raising your prices and you're extending the time that each project gets for you to work on. So you're not rushed all the time between 100 different projects. You maybe have like five or six or fewer going on at one time. Is that what you're saying? I just want to be clear.
Exactly. And I mean, you know, something I'll describe about the program is there's two tracks. So the one is get your business ready and the other is start practicing digital strategy. Mm. And I actually think that some of the meatier parts are actually more in the sort of preparing your business. It's the stuff that people don't actually expect to be learning. It's a lot more of the soft skills. Like, how are you actually talking to your clients? Mm. You know, how are you actually positioning yourself? I feel like the part that is harder to learn is some of those behind the scenes. Like, here's how I actually run a client meeting. Like, here's the proposal that I actually sent to a client and I'm sharing with you with her permission.
Yeah.
And this is how the first call went. And I go into great detail about here's how I get a $15,000 project. Here's what the process looks like. Here's how after 6 months, after some ideas came into play, we actually shifted gears and suddenly that's a year-long project.
Yeah.
And I tell people kind of that they're like, what do you do on the fly when it does change and suddenly the scope is different? Great. We revisit the proposal. Let's look at what we've done and let's look at what is still left to do. And so my approach is quite flexible. Mm. I'm always willing to kind of pivot and I'm the kind of person that's always throwing new ideas out there. And in the beginning, I used to kind of shoot myself in the foot because I'd be like, oh, we should add an online course. And the client's like, great. And I'm like, oh crap, I didn't add that to the budget.
Now
oh,
I have to do that.
I guess I have to do it. But now what I'll say is great. Okay. So, you know, that's going to add like another month or two. Like, are you okay with that? Let's do that. Mm-hmm. Great. Sounds amazing. So sometimes I'll shift from a fixed fee to a retainer and say, hey, what do you think about actually moving to a retainer for the next 6 months? And we can chip away at this and launch in December. And I feel like that flexibility has actually been a huge bonus. And I just think knowing what your customer needs and being willing to kind of pivot, having that empathy for your client is totally key. And it's changed my business.
Yeah, I think that's probably a good time to transition to a part of the discussion on what the digital strategy process actually looks like from start to finish, and then maybe add some client stuff in there. So let's do this. Let's say that I'm a new prospective client. I've just reached out to you and I'm interested in hiring you. In sort of broad strokes, can you walk us through what our working process would be like from start to finish? Obviously, I've seen some of your, you know, your workflow stuff. It's pretty extensive. It's very long. So you don't have to go into every stage. But if you could maybe create bigger stages and kind of break that down for us, that'd be great.
Yeah, I'll kind of summarize. And again, depending on someone's budget, depending on the size of the project or kind of how involved I'm going to get, it might be a little different for each client. And I do work with a lot of people that I'm really close with too. So sometimes I feel like they've given me enough permission that I can kind of take it and run with it. But essentially, I'm going to find out, what do you actually want at the end of the day? So what are your objectives? What are your goals? What are your values? Like you were saying, how long has your business been around? How long has your brand been around? How are you perceived currently? Like, so it's a lot of kind of auditing, right? Like, let's see what's actually happening for you already. What do we have to work with? Sometimes I'll even, you know, creep on social media and I'll just say like, what's happening? Like, what kind of things, how are people responding to you? What's the engagement look like? You know, what's the kind of sense? So I do a lot of research and digging, and then I'll actually research the market as well. Like, what is happening in the market in the space that you're playing?
I find that the term market research is, I mean, it's something you hear all over the place, but I just want to let everybody know, like, sort of demystify the term. That's one thing I try to do as much as possible on the show, is just make sure that if there's a buzzword or a term that gets used a lot, that we actually take the time to say, this is what that actually means. Because I'm not sure people really know what it means to do market research. What do you do when you do market research?
And I mean, as a solo person, I'm probably going to do very scaled back market research from what, you know, a larger agency can do. But it's literally researching that market. So if you're like a nutritionist, for example, I'm going to research that market. I'm going to say, I'm going to look at keyword trending. I'm going to look at, you know, Google Trends. Google Trends is a great tool for that. How are people on Facebook, for example? I'll look at the most well-known companies or services in that niche and say, all right, who are the major players? Who do people go to when they're looking for advice on XYZ? And so social for me is a place where I typically do a lot of, you know, social listening. So I'll look on Facebook pages, I'll look on Twitter. You know, you can look at what's happening on Pinterest. You know, there's so many different places to look depending on the market, right? So I'm pretty entrenched in Facebook. So for me, that's a great place to do research too, because people don't know necessarily that you're, I don't want to say like, I'm listening in, like I'm just always listening to what's happening, right? So I'm just sort of, I'm making heuristic observations. So
thanks for clearing that up. You can go on with the overview now that we've got that. So what happens after market research?
So you do your creeping and then you start setting some goals, you know, so we can't necessarily do everything at once. So what's the next thing that we want to do? Do we want to increase your sales by 20%? Do we want to start doing a list building campaign? Do we want to launch an online program for you or a course, right? So what does that look like? And of course, that goal is going to be different for everyone. And I might help someone set that goal, or they may come to me with very specific goals. So it all depends on, again, how new the business is or how established they are. So once they set some goals, we outline a plan of action. Like, how are we actually going to pull it off? What's it going to take? How long is it going to take? Do we need to hire extra people on your team or for me? You know, how is the design going to get us there? Mm-hmm. So sometimes it's not even design related, right? Sometimes I'll say, great, sounds like you need to put a blog in place. Like, you guys aren't blogging at all. There's no inbound marketing. So I'll often encourage people, you need to build your audience, you need to build some traction. You need people knowing that you're the go-to person for that thing that you're talking about. So if I know someone's launching an online course, I'm going to say like 6 months before, you guys need to start building up some epic content that positions you as that go-to person.
So a few questions. First of all, from the time that you start this conversation with them to the time that work actually starts getting done, how long does that typically take? This whole planning phase?
Oh, again, that's different for every client. I have some clients I've worked with for a year. Sometimes it's 3 months. Sometimes it's a couple weeks. It really does depend on the size of the project and the budget, of course.
Yeah. Well, I guess that's my question, or that gets to the heart of the question, is because people are going to have different budgets, that's obviously going to determine what type of client you can work with. Because I would imagine that clients with smaller budgets who want a quick solution for their money, you know, they're like, well, we have a very small budget, which means I can't afford to have you on for 6 months or a year to get it done, quote unquote, right. They're like, you know, are those even people that you work with? I guess, first of all,
usually not. Okay. And again, with Digital Strategy School, now I have an amazing pool of designers that, great, here's some people that need work. I'm happy to pass you off to somebody.
Okay. And so the second of all on that is, the people who do stick around, if it's not going to be the same for every client, maybe you can give me sort of like an average, just so I can give people an idea of what's a reasonable amount of time to plan before you actually get into deliverables. Because, I think this has come up multiple episodes, is I don't think people spend enough time planning. I think strategy and planning and making sure you have all of that set before you start actually doing stuff ends up saving you tons of time, lots of spin, lots of like wasted effort. So what does that on average, I guess, look like for you time-wise?
Oh gosh, it is really hard to say. Because I do feel like they're sort of all over the map. For example, I have a woman that I've been working
with.
Maybe
break it down by types of client then. Like, say you have a $12,000 client, what does that planning period typically look like?
I'd say maybe 6 months, or sorry, the full project would take place around 6 months. So, now admittedly, because I know my tendency is to always be in kind of strategist mode and big picture mode, even in like month four, I'll be like, oh, I was just, you know, I just thought of this thing. Mm-hmm. What do you think if we were to add, you know, XYZ? And they're like, great, sounds amazing. And that project might extend 4 months, right? So that's kind of how I operate. And they know that I'm always thinking about them and kind of, what's going to happen for their site. And so if I'm adding suggestions, it's not because, oh, I just want more money, and more months that we're working together. But naturally, the projects that I work on end up going very long term. So I have clients that I've worked with for 3-4 years. Mm. And they're like, great, what's the next project we can work on, or help me with my next launch? So it tends to be long term.
So how does that work? Do you have like a subscription or retainer program that, or like a offering that you have? Or do you just say, hey, we're getting to the end of what we initially budgeted and planned for. Let's do it again, basically. Or how do you do that?
Yeah, again, it does depend. But I would say, for example, if we're coming up on the end of that 6 months, I might say, hey, you know, we're coming up, but it looks like there's still more to do, or there's more pieces in place. Mm-hmm. Do you want to continue working together and on a retainer basis? So typically when I quote a project, I'll actually break it down. So if it is a $12,000 project and we're working for 6 months, great, $2,000 a month for the next 6 months. And if the project keeps extending, I'll say, hey, do you want to continue that retainer? Do you want to do a slightly smaller retainer and it's mostly just maintenance stuff? Let me know. I'm very kind of go with the flow that way. And I feel like I charge enough to be very generous, very generous with my clients. So even though they're paying me a lot, they're still getting way more than they're paying for. And I think they know that and they feel that. That's what's most important to me, is that even though they're paying a lot, they're like, yes, like I want to work with her, and I'm getting way more than I'm paying for.
So you guys offer a lot of services, and I've mentioned this already, but I'm interested in the execution of those services now. Do you guys do all that yourself? Do you outsource? Do you work with trusted partners? How do you get everything under that service list actually done?
I would definitely pull in key people. For example, if someone needed some advanced search engine optimization, like I can make a search engine friendly website, but I'm not an expert at SEO. So I might make certain recommendations and say, cool, based on the fact that you have a brick and mortar business and local search might be important, you probably want to talk to this guy, and I'd recommend he could set up a campaign for you. And I would kind of recommend that they go to the experts. So I know enough that I can make the recommendations, and parts of it I'm going to be more interested in. Mm-hmm. I want to help you do the audience building. I want to help you actually put together the online course and figure out what that launch sequence is going to look like. So, and this is what I encourage all the students in my course, is you can't be an expert at all the different pieces.
Yeah.
And some of you are going to be great with the branding side of things. Great. So your strategy documents are going to be way heavier on the branding side, and your recommendations might pull more heavily from pushing the branding. Yeah. Great. Other people, it's the SEO, you know, so other people, it's going to be content and blogging, because that's their kind of niche. So everyone's going to make different recommendations based on where their strengths are. Mm-hmm. And all I do is encourage them to learn a bit about the other pieces that they don't really know, so that you get that well-rounded experience. Mm-hmm. But I always encourage, great, hire someone to help you with your social media if that's something that you're not strong at, you know, hire the experts. But to answer your question, like I do the execution on all the projects. I'm doing the design, the development, integrating all the pieces. The only time I don't necessarily dive totally deep is I don't do the Infusionsoft setup. They'll send me, for example, the forms, and I can add them to the page, but I don't go in and mess around with Infusionsoft stuff.
Gotcha. So I guess at the end of the day, you're charging for work that you do. You're not charging and then outsourcing and stuff like that, right?
Nope.
Okay, cool. Just wanted to, because I think when people, so far we've actually talked to a lot of people who have businesses and they do outsource a lot. So they're in charge of booking and managing and different kind of higher management level things. But then they hire in a designer and they hire in a couple developers, and that's how.
That's great. If that works well.
No, that's totally great. But I think this is, sounds like you're getting your hands dirty a lot, which is cool.
Definitely. Like I've, and as we were talking about earlier, I recently hired a project manager, right? So this is the first time I'm suddenly having someone else on my team that kind of knows what's coming in the pipeline and kind of knows how I work. Mm-hmm. I just thought, how am I ever going to find someone that jives with the way that I work? Because it probably seems crazy, right? Sleeping in, I work late, but I feel like I have a lot of sort of flexibility in terms of how I work. And again, oh, let's just change that project into like a 6-month retainer. Like I can roll with the punches because I've been doing it for so long. I wasn't sure how a project manager would kind of, where are they going to fit in? Are they going to kind of,
right.
So I was really nervous for a long time about bringing anyone onto my team. I'm like, who's going to be able to work with the way that I work? And that's why I feel like I found this unicorn of a woman who's, it's making it a lot easier and giving me a lot more structure, which still is allowing me to be free within the constraints of that structure. So
that's cool. That's great. Let's talk clients for a second. How do you deal with people who contact you in panic mode? They love what you have to offer, but they want it right now because their business really needs it.
Not available. Gotcha. No, I don't do any rush work, no emergency timelines. I've had those years where I'm like, oh my gosh, like I just feel like I'm putting out fires all the time. Mm-hmm. It's super stressful. And you can't give everybody your attention when you've got like 20 different projects that just feel like they're all emergencies. Yeah. So it took me about a year to say no to everything that came in the door and let go of 2 to 3 clients that great clients in some ways. I love the work. I love the people, but I couldn't deal with the super fast, like, oh my gosh, I need this by like Monday morning. Great. There goes my weekend. I don't want to work like that anymore. So even though I think you're awesome, you know, I'll pass you off to another designer that needs the work and is building their portfolio and actually doesn't mind doing that work.
How do you, because I think that's, you know, obviously what you're describing is the kind of work-life balance that I think a lot of people aspire to.
I haven't figured it out yet, by the way.
Right. But the ability, I mean, that's a big step though. Just the ability to say, you know what? I don't work that way. I do it like this. But in order for you to consistently get clients that think the same way, I guess I'm wondering, you know, do you have to coach people down that path or do you only work with people who come to you already having kind of got it that, you know, business is a process. Online strategy is a process. It's something that we're going to do in iterative bursts. It's not something that we're going to sit down and hash out in an afternoon or a week or a weekend or whatever. Yeah. Sorry. What is that? Those conversations look like and how do people tend to come to you, on that issue?
I'd say as of late, maybe in the last year or so, I don't need to coach anyone. Like mm-hmm. if they're coming to me and I have that first call with them, it's because I know we're going to work together and we make sure we're on the same page. In the past, before I really, really knew kind of what are my strengths? How do I work? What does my process really look like? It was okay, great. Like that client seems like a good fit. And then, you know, we start working together and, maybe they delay for like 2 months and they say, mm-hmm. Oh, sorry, we need to go produce our content. Sorry. And they disappear for 2 months. And I say, that's no problem. I don't mind being flexible, but I'm going to expect the same flexibility if I have to take on new clients. And then when you're ready, I may not be ready. Right. Yeah. So I just sort of say, I'm super happy to be flexible about this, but I need to make sure we're kind of on the same page about that. And so, you know, sometimes that process can be a little tricky to make sure, want to make sure you're happy, but we have to respect both of our boundaries and our time. And that stuff takes time to figure out. And the language of that takes time to figure out. Like, how do I word this thing to a client? It's really awkward, but most of the time it doesn't need to be awkward. If you just say things with a little bit of kindness and directness and keep it really simple, don't overly explain those long emails. Like it's awkward. Doesn't need to be.
That is what makes it awkward. It's like exerting your boundaries or explaining to people what your boundaries are. That's not awkward at all. That's, you know, that I
people
think
people respect it.
They respect it. It comes across as mature. It comes across as collected and professional. But if you're like, you know, I discovered that this is the way I work because of the, you know, way I was raised and I had this experience when I was 16, you know, like,
you're like, I don't need to know.
Yeah. That's where it starts to get weird. That's where it starts to get awkward.
Definitely. Yeah.
There are all kinds of clients. We could talk about client examples all day. One more that I wanted to ask, particularly because of the structure of this service, it's ongoing. There's a lot of different parts to it. Do you ever have clients who want to pick and choose a la carte style? Like you're offering a full strategy package, but they're like, I love all that, but I just want the web design and I just want the course built. Let's do that. Do you get that? Or do you have a way of deflecting that or redirecting that or whatever?
No, because that's a good question. I mean, the service has kind of evolved organically based on the work I was already doing for people, right? So people would come to me for a web design and then we would talk. And then they're like, oh, I get that you were so much more than a web designer. Just based on the questions I was asking them. They're like, oh, nobody, you know, a lot of designers dive into like, well, who do you like? Whose sites do you like? And kind of what color? And they're already thinking about the sort of aesthetic appearance. But I was asking, well, have you guys thought about doing an online program? Was that something you were thinking about? And they're like, oh, well, we thought that was like 5 years down the road. And I was like, well, what if we could do an MVP, like a minimum viable version of that within a few months? we didn't know that was and so once you get people hooked on the possibilities, it's way easier to, you know, sell them on a bigger project, because they're like, I get that she's seeing this as a much bigger possibility, but I don't sell them on the giant thing right away. I say, okay, cool, let's get the minimum viable experience or product, whatever it is, up and running in like 3 months, right? Mm-hmm. So let's get the first version of your site up. Great. Then the next 3 months might be cool. Let's work on that online program now, or that launch campaign, or whatever it is. So I kind of spell out what those different phases look like in a proposal. Mm-hmm. And so the proposal is not line itemized. It's more like phase one, 12 to 15,000. They're like,
yeah,
you know, it includes all the things that we're going to need to do. And because I don't like to get really specific about brand strategy is going to like cost this much and take this much time, it never works that way. It never does.
It's always process much more organic than that. Even if you want it to be totally structured and you try to make it structured, it's going to turn out however it is, it turns out.
And I think it is important to track your time and you know, like that article said, giving that, you know, full price without having all the data to support it. So mm-hmm. I think it is important to know, how long does it typically take you to do this? Great. It's good to know. But, you know, some projects I don't dive in as deep on the research. I just don't. Sometimes it's like, that's not as important to this client. Like mm-hmm. it's just not that big a deal. So I think knowing how to read between the lines and really know, like, what does your client really need and what are they asking for? I don't give everybody a super fancy 40-page document. Not everybody gets it. Sometimes I'll give them a summary, or sometimes I'll just have an idea based on something they've said. So it's not always super polished and here's that final document. And clients don't care. They just want to know that the site is going to do something awesome for them.
That's awesome. And I think that's really practical. You
know, it is.
Because you're right. I mean, and plus that gives you, if you give yourself the permission to operate however you need to operate, I think what that does is it allows you to get on with the work and allows you to meet each client where they're at. Because like, you know, some clients, they may be at a place where they both want and need something formal, something like that they can share with other people on their team. Exactly. And in that case, they would get that big report. If you're dealing with, you know, granted a successful larger budget, but kind of mom and pop shop who just wants like, you know, a document that outlines everything that's maybe on Google Docs or whatever, that it's not, you're not giving them any less service. You're just giving them what they need in order to give you the green light, basically.
Exactly. Not everybody needs the same level of documentation. Mm-hmm. And I think that's probably something that surprised a lot of the digital strategy school students is that I'm like, hey, guess what? Every project is different. Guess what? But if you have a process that you can kind of fall back on and you kind of, you know what the different parts are and you get to know your clients, you're going to be able to kind of fall back on these processes, but also adapt and be willing to shift gears. If that doesn't really make sense for this client, cool, skip it. Like it doesn't, you have the flexibility and the freedom to do that. You get to design your business the way you want to.
Absolutely. Well, I think we're getting up against our time limit for the interview, which means it's time to leave with a parting thought. At the end of each episode, I like to ask our guests to leave us with a parting thought that encapsulates their take on our main topic. Today, we've been talking about the benefits of transitioning from web designer to digital strategist. I hope we've covered the big picture of digital strategy and explained why it may be a good move for some in the community to shift into. Perhaps the one thing we haven't covered, which I'd like to end with, is how to gain the knowledge necessary to make that transition. So my final question to you, Maria, is, you know, for someone who's convinced, they're like, okay, I would like to make this transition, how do they go about equipping themselves with the knowledge that they need in order to start offering a full digital strategy service?
Am I allowed to say, sign up for my program?
You can, but maybe also cite some of the sources and things that you did when a program like that wasn't available.
Oh, man. I'm always taking courses, doing research on marketing, places like Unbounce. Unbounce is a really great resource. SEO Moz, or Moz, however you pronounce that. Learning about inbound marketing, email launching, like all that stuff is really important. So
it sounds a lot like what you've been talking about this whole time has been basically knowing better than most people how an online business operates and functions and what the moving pieces are to that. So I guess to kind of frame the question that way, you've already stated some, but what are some other places that and other resources that you've used to kind of train yourself in how to be an online entrepreneur and be able to offer a successful version of that to your clients?
I'm always watching what's happening online. I'm just paying attention to what are people doing in the online marketing space? What are the current trends in online marketing right now? Research, Google. I'm just always kind of always researching to find out what's happening online. Like there's lots of people who've inspired me, like Nathan Berry was a really great resource. Brennan Dunn talks a lot about, you know, freelancers transitioning into higher rates. You know, how do you move more into that consultant rate? So I start studying, if I want to be perceived as an expert, how do experts behave? What do they do? What do they do differently? So what do I need to know to kind of position myself as such? So,
and then whatever that answer is, just go after it. Cause it sounds like that's what you did.
What are the experts doing? Yeah.
Well, I really appreciate you coming on the show. I think it was a great interview. So Marie, thank you for being on Divi Nation.
Thanks for having me.
Don't forget, if you're watching this video on YouTube or Facebook, take a moment to subscribe, follow, like, and/or share. It really helps. Thanks.